What's cracking, everyone? It's been a while, and I hope we've all been looking after yourselves over the past few weeks. For me, long story cut short, I came out of band practice about 5 weeks ago, and as I was walking backwards, my foot slipped on a lip, bent at a 90 degree angle, and my whole body weight just pushed on that one foot, so I fell down like a sack of potatoes. But my mate thought it was funny because I was chatting away and having a crack with a big smile on my face, and he says as I fell down he seen the life just drain from my face, and for some reason he thought it was the most hilarious thing ever. Not only did that happen to me then, I also had to drive home, which was over an hour away, using the same foot that I just mangled, so that was great. The laptop I had home was just utterly useless. Wouldn't have been able to record anything from that, so I wasn't able to get anything recorded at all, which was just absolutely grim. Though I haven't made any videos over the past few weeks, me and Carl have made significant progress in terms of the podcast channel, and we are expected to have the first video launched on the 4th of October. We are still at the testing phase, but we're hoping that everything goes well and we can get the first video recorded sometime this week. In terms of the podcast name, it's called Truth Stranger Than Fiction, and the name was suggested by Richard, so congrats Richard for providing us with that name. In regards to my testimony, I will have that ready over the next few weeks. Me and my best half did decide that we were going to homeschool our wee one, and so we've been homeschooling our wee one for the past few weeks. Though we do feel it's the right decision that we did make, it is kind of time consuming, and so we're still trying to get used to adjusting to the new life and trying to organize our time and trying to make time for other things. But I will definitely have that testimony for you within the next few weeks. Anyways, enough of this. Let's go ahead and dive in and watch some more disturbing creepy TikToks.
A UK facial recognition security system, FaceWatch, wrongfully identified a 19-year-old girl for being a shoplifter. While shopping at Home Bargains in Manchester, Sarah, who wishes to remain anonymous, was kicked out of the store and publicly shamed for supposedly having a history in theft. Sarah claims that she has never stolen anything in her life. How could FaceWatch make such a big mistake? With the help of Big Brother Watch, a digital rights group, Sarah is taking both FaceWatch and Home Bargains to court for the way that they treated her. Sarah isn't the only case where face scanning technology has failed. Sean Thompson, a London anti-knife crime community worker, was detained for 30 minutes by the Metropolitan Police after facial recognition made an incorrect match. Even with the repeated instances of inaccuracy regarding the technology, facial recognition is continuing to grow beyond the UK. California-based restaurant Cali Express by Flippy has implemented a facial recognition system where customers can now pay for their food with a simple scan of their face. The UK Border Force is also eager to use facial recognition as a means of security in airports. Would you trust facial recognition?
How does it make you feel knowing that any shop you go into could potentially have facial recognition cameras that is creating and building a profile of you, of your biometrics, among other data, and then sending that data over through to a system that could potentially be owned by a private firm, knowing that you never gave consent to give any privacy rights away in the first place?
Did you know that there's three things that will be revealed after our deaths that exist now?
What do you mean?
What?
There is a letter from Queen Elizabeth written to the mayor of Sydney, and she says, please don't open this letter until 2085. And it's like hidden in a, or it's being held in a like secret vault in Sydney, Australia.
Interesting.
Wow.
It'll sign Elizabeth. Is it going to be revealed? Like something big. But then there's a movie called 100 Years, the movie you'll never see.
Oh.
But it's starring John Malkovich, and it's to be released in theaters or to the public in 2115.
Wow.
They filmed it in 2015, and no one will see it until 100 years goes by.
Lame.
What if they know exactly what happens to us and they just made it?
What if John Malkovich is a time traveler?
Weird.
And then the last thing, which was super weird, Jackie Kennedy's bloody pink suit, the suit that she was wearing when JFK was shot, it's been held in a vault secret. Like no one's allowed to see it. And they said they will release it to the public October
26, 2103. Weird. Why?
Alien blood.
Don't know.
I'm curious about the contents of the letter from Elizabeth. Maybe she does confess to us after all that they are in fact a family of reptilians. Who knows? But I am more curious about the film because 2115, none of us are going to be here. You know, minimum production is 50 to 100 million for a movie. So if it's not about the money, then what's it about? So let me know what your thoughts are.
A new term at David Game College in London. New friends, a new classroom, but no new teacher. Instead, core subjects, including English, maths, and science, will be taught by AI.
I have simplified the concept and graphics.
An artificially intelligent computer program that understands answers and then asks relevant questions back.
Let's see an example.
The AI can take in all of their answers, correct or incorrect, and plot exactly where they are in the curriculum. So it has kind of a higher knowledge of exactly where that student is, and then it can adapt questions to support them. It gives them material they don't know and lets them revise the stuff they do much later.
Virtual teachers are enhanced by virtual reality, helping students take a 21st century look at the curriculum.
You can tell apart more things because you can turn it around and see it form in front of you as you like as well.
How different is it to a human teacher?
Well, you're not afraid to ask questions because a robot wouldn't judge, and you don't even need to ask the questions. It can just tell where you need help and where you don't.
Activators or silencers.
It's being used here for GCSEs. Critics say education is about more than just passing exams.
Learning's a social experience. We are living in an environment currently where we have the second most unhappiest 15-year-olds. That is down to a direction of travel where children are spending more and more time on their own, more and more time in isolation. To increase that further through learning through a headset will only increase young people's unhappiness.
Critics may argue this is going to replace the role of human teachers.
Absolutely not. AI is not going away. Education is going to be disrupted, but teachers cannot be replaced, and nor should they be replaced.
Human so-called learning coaches are on hand and still lead on subjects like art and drama. AI, it turns out, is still better at copying than creating.
There's going to be a lot of mixed opinions regarding the direction school and education is heading towards, but I do feel that interpersonal intelligence is being removed from schools, and that's the ability to be able to communicate effectively with others, as well as being able to understand others, among other things. And we can see evidence of that being removed over the last 4 years, maybe prior to that. But for example, our daughter, just before she was homeschooled, before going to school, she would have her head down low and looked like she was shriveled up inside. And then after school, she would just be in bad form or just be quiet. And since transitioning her to being homeschooled, instantly we've been able to see her become the social butterfly that she's always been.
This year and forward, the sun is now exposing everything. So you know how people have been putting these protective films over their car just so their car don't fade and all these type of things? Well, nobody expected for this new sun to be hitting the way that it has been hitting. And because of this, this is the side effects of the cars in China. So they are calling these things pregnant cars because they are literally being forced to swell because of the heat of the sun. This is in China, y'all. You guys are privy to what this new sun along with these new temperatures are doing to different parts of the world, y'all. You got pregnant cars appearing in China and different parts of the world, and then Saudi Arabia erecting over 250 umbrellas to create like a shade force field for them so they don't have to experience this new temperatures worldwide. I mean, look at this. Look at what I recorded in Jacksonville just the other day, y'all. That shit looks like an open portal. This thing looked just like this without me recording it, y'all. I was just so dumbfounded. I was like, what is going on here? Looks like a giant eye. It looks like a football. It looks like the universal yoni. It looks like so many things, a cat eye, a dragon's eye. And I have a feeling we're going to see a lot more things taking an adverse side effect to what the sun has been doing lately, y'all.
That doesn't look like a sun to me. That looks like something that if I was to approach it, I would probably see the head of a doctor, and I would probably be born again in a completely different way. Vogrino out loud. Mr. Sir, I can see the top of the baby's head. Can you please push, please? Mr. Neville, you may have to go along for this one. Congratulations, Mrs. Sir. You got yourself a noddy.
Thank you.
If that is the map of Paris from years ago, I honestly wouldn't like to see what way it is today. And from the year of 23 to 24, there's been almost 15,000 attacks on Christians and churches in the West. We know what way it is over here in the UK and Ireland. But given what's happening over in Paris, I'm surprised they haven't just renamed it as Paristan. If you enjoy this type of content, subscribe as I upload every Mondays, Wednesdays and Fridays.
Do you want to speak to me? Are you applying for asylum? I'm a journalist. You're applying, are you?
Yeah, I was.
Okay, and were you successful?
No.
Can I ask you where you're from?
The United States.
You're United States and you're applying for asylum from America?
Yeah, you know what?
Okay, yeah, I'd love to know, yeah. I'm a journalist, by the way. Philip DeWire is my name.
As they practice mind control in the United States.
Okay.
The military has been attacking me for years. Okay. And, it's caused me a ton of problems. Right. To the problem where I can't even work and I'm a philosophy major.
Wow, you're a philosophy major in the US?
From the United States, and okay. I can teach. And I can't even upload or download any documents on my computer.
Okay. And is it because of your political views, maybe, they're doing this?
That's right. I was against the torture at Guantanamo Bay and the unjust war that was corrupt. It was all for oil and money. Uh-huh. Yeah, okay. That was during Guantanamo Bay, of course.
So you would be kind of outspoken about the corrupt system of government?
Outspoken. I called them and told them to stop torturing people. That's right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And if you were to vote in the next election, would you be a Trump supporter or a Kamala?
Neither. I'm not political. It's completely corrupt in the United States. Everything is corrupt in the United States.
Okay. Smart. You seem to be a smart woman. You have your research done, yeah?
Yes, I do.
Why come to Ireland for asylum?
Because it's a quiet, normal seeming life. It's a life where you can live quiet and peacefully, I think.
I'm sorry to break the news for you, but that's not far. That couldn't be further from the truth.
That's what I'm finding out. Yeah, I'm finding.
Unfortunately.
Most Western countries, if not all countries in the world, are corrupt. I think that free will kill us all in the next 500 years.
Free will.
Mankind, yes. It's called existentialism. If you read Sartre and Simone de Beauvoir. Okay. Albert Camus, uh-huh. They all give very good views on this, especially Sartre. If you have the full comprehension of the Cartesian, full cogito of the comprehension of the full cogito, which is ergo sum. I think therefore I am. Okay. Je suis.
Do you want to give your full name?
No.
What's your first name?
No. Yeah, I am. I am. Yes, I would like to.
Okay, listen, thanks very much for talking to me there.
She comes across as a very well-educated woman, and we welcome many people from many countries to come here and set life up. And even though we do have 50 shades of green, our grass really isn't greener on this side either, and it certainly doesn't protect you from mind control propaganda. But in terms of her views of not supporting Trump or Camel Toe, what's your thoughts on that?
When you start digging into our true history, the scraps that we are left anyways, you notice a very interesting thing when it comes to giants. You see, these photo giants that we have are between 8 to 9 feet. But when you go a bit further back to the news articles with all the stories of the remains of giants being found, those were upwards of 10 feet tall. And I don't think these books were even for those giant people pictured. Heck, they definitely weren't for us. You would need a horse and buggy alone just to bring them to the reading club. But the giant doorways, all that massive architecture, they were built for those giants that were 10 feet and larger. Perhaps after the reset and the removal of those giant trees, the oxygen levels shrank, and the giants started naturally shrinking along with it. Or perhaps there was some genetic alterations along the way. An old world form of weaponized genetics that caused the giants to shrink and deform to the giants that we have today, the ones with giganticism, where you can easily spot the deformities. Unlike any of the giants in these pictures, the further back in history you go, the larger they get. Question everything, friends. Until next time.
In the early 18th century, there was a giant who lived in Scotland by the name of Angus MacAskill, and he stood 8 feet tall and was diagnosed as not having giganticism, and he was so strong that he was actually able to lift a 3,000-pound anchor to his chest and even performed in the likes of B.T. Barnum's circus. So we know that giants date back to the days of Nephilim, but is it possible that there could be a secret civilization of giants that exists today?
Watch this. Man talks about idol worshipping on society today. Wake up.
The show comes on with these religious fanatics. They were crazy. Well, you would think they were crazy if you didn't understand their culture and their religion. See, that's just the thing. They were worshippers of idols. And they took things to extremes. They painted their bodies. They wore these ridiculous costumes. They chanted, they danced, they made sacrifices to their idols. They had built these enormous temples to worship their idols in. It seemed like their entire existence climaxed into this one scenario, this one over-the-top act of worship. You don't really relate, do you? Let's try it again. I was watching TV the other day, and this show comes on with these religious fanatics. They were crazy. See, that's just the thing. They were worshippers of idols, and they took things to extremes. They painted their bodies. They wore these ridiculous costumes. They chanted, they danced, they made sacrifices to their idols. They had built these enormous temples to worship their idols in. It seemed like their entire existence climaxed into this one scenario, this one over-the-top act of worship. Idol worship. It's not just about golden calves anymore.
Honestly, there's a few things that I struggle with being a Christian, and I'm sure you're the same too, and one of those is being a football fan. I've been a football fan for most of my life, but over the past year and a half, 2 years, I have been thinking and considering about trying to remove that. I've made zero progress so far, but at the end of the day, we all fall short from the glory of God, so we all can't be perfect.
And a national abortion ban.
It's a lie. I'm not signing a ban, and there's no reason to sign a ban.
Understand, in his Project 2025, there would be a national abortion monitor.
What she says is an absolute lie.
There is no state in this country where it is legal to kill a baby after it's born.
Nowhere in America is a woman carrying a pregnancy to term and asking for an abortion.
The infant would be delivered. The infant would be kept comfortable. The infant would be resuscitated if that's what the mother and the family desired. And then a discussion would ensue between the physicians and the mothers.
Donald Trump, the candidate, has said in this election there will be a bloodbath if this and the outcome of this election is not to his liking.
It was a different term, and it was a term that related to energy. We're going to put a 100% tariff on every single car that comes across the line. And you're not going to be able to sell those guys. If I get elected. Now, if I don't get elected, it's going to be a bloodbath.
Let's remember Charlottesville. There were fine people on each side.
Very fine people on both sides. And I'm not talking about the neo-Nazis and the white nationalists, because they should be condemned totally.
Tim Walz and I are both gun owners. We're not taking anybody's guns away.
Let us finally pass an assault weapons ban and universal background checks and red flag laws.
Well, I will tell you, I agreed with President Biden's decision to pull out of Afghanistan. Four presidents said they would, and Joe Biden did. And as a result, America's taxpayers are not paying the $300 million a day we were paying for that endless war. And as of today, there is not one member of the United States military who is in active duty in a combat zone in any war zone around the world. The first time this
century. We're what?
But let's understand.
So where the fuck are we right now?
We all know the politicians lie to some degree, but when you're lying to that extent, you're a pathological liar. And honestly, it doesn't matter who they are or how you value them in your life. Someone who is a pathological liar cannot be trusted.
Jaxa.
then we're just up there.
I've seen strange patterns and chemtrails in the sky, but I've never seen something where it looks as though the sky was closed over and stitched up. We live in a time where online our eyes can't be trusted, but the eerie thought I had when watching this was, what if this was a real person and we just witnessed them drop to the ground?
With solo cups, some metal foil, and a speaker cone spring. But when I put this thing up against my beehive... Have y'all ever heard of anything like this before?
But there's no sunlight coming in and hitting that light, right? So I'm holding my phone, I'm just gonna walk closer and closer. And as we walk closer, look at the reflection. Damn it, I had the phone plugged in. Look at the reflection. The lights are on. But the lights are not on.
Now they're all watching the fucking movie. Look at this shit. What the fuck?
Very 80s looking guitar. And every time I strum, we like that. Shit like that happens. Every time I mess with this thing. Like that.
I really hope the first clip regarding the bees talking is real, I really do. And as for the last clip showing the guitar, I'm pretty sure if he played the guitar right, he wouldn't have such an angry spirit.
What if I told you self-checkout machines aren't just about the convenience of a speedier checkout? They're actually behavioral data collection hubs. Every time you use one, it's not just scanning your groceries, it's scanning you. The sensors built into these machines are tracking your hand movements, the speed of your actions, even the micro expressions on your face when something goes wrong. They're collecting all that info and building a profile on how you behave under stress, how impatient you are, how you react to small inconveniences. This data, it's being fed into a massive AI system designed to predict and influence your future shopping habits. Ever notice how the machine always seems to glitch just when you're in a hurry? That's not an accident. It's a test to see how you handle frustration so they can optimize ads and product placements based on your stress responses. Don't say I didn't warn you, buddy. I suggest you stick to curbside.
We don't know what truth this holds, but would it really be surprising if this was the case? Take, for example, facial recognition cameras and how they operate. Who's to say that in the near future, if not already, these checkouts holding the same kind of technological advancements? And speaking of self-checkouts, would you rather use self-checkout, or would you rather have someone serve you?
Mr. Speaker, graphic lessons on oral sex, how to choke your partner safely, and 72 genders. This is what passes for relationships and sex education in British schools. Across the country, children are being subjected to lessons that are age inappropriate, extreme, sexualizing, and inaccurate, often using resources from unregulated organizations that are actively campaigning to undermine parents. This is not a victory for equality, it is a catastrophe for childhood. Will my right honourable friend honour his commitment to end inappropriate sex education by commissioning an independent inquiry into the nature and extent of this safeguarding scandal?
Yeah. Things like this make me realise that me and my best half made the right decision in homeschooling our child. I mean, how to educate your child on choking your partner safely? I mean, you see, 20, 30 years ago, if you were a man and you walked into a library and you went up to a librarian and says, listen, I just wanted to know if you could help me locate the book where I can, you know, choke my partner safely, you'd be clipped around the eye, turned around, kicked up the hoop and told to slide on. smash that like button and subscribe button, and hope to see you all again in the next video. Much love to you all, and take care.